Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. I know it has been far too long, and by my calculations, no less than 3 weeks of 2024 have elapsed, but the wait is finally over and tech news has returned. And just in time too, because one of three RTX 40 Super cards have already launched, the 4070 Super. Two more GPU launches are coming this week, 4070 Ti Super and the RX 7600 XT 16GB. Rumors of next-gen AM5 CPUs are swirling like the cold and bitter winds of a winter storm, and I'm starting to think that all these tech companies did not abide by my mandate to not do anything newsworthy for 3 or 4 weeks, CES activities notwithstanding, which was ambitious, I suppose, but throws my scheduling right off. But I shall muddle through nonetheless. I have my camera, my script, I've got you guys, and oh yes, a tasty beer too. This is a heady topper provided to me by John. Drink from the can. So there it is, and let's proceed with the inaugural tech news of 2024. Cheers. It's way better out of the can.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware Store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. The big news this week was NVIDIA's RTX 4070 Super launch, one of three promised GPUs launching in a three-week cycle designed to optimize media coverage for NVIDIA. Although the Tuesday morning review embargo lift cut it a bit short for many CES returnees, myself included, nevertheless, there were still plenty of reviews to choose from, with many of them echoing the same generally positive refrain. This is what the 4070 non-Super launch should have been like a year or so ago, because with the 4070 Super launch, NVIDIA did that thing that they used to do all the time, offer substantially more performance than the previous year's card, about 12 to 18% more on average for the 4070 Super versus the non-Super, at the same $600 MSRP. And while there's some reluctance to give NVIDIA too much credit since they were the ones who started ramping up their prices in the first place with the RTX 20 series, it is generally good news that the 4070 Super, which is roughly on par with a 3080 Ti performance-wise, can be bought for $600. It also lands right in the middle of AMD's performance gap between the $500 RX 7800 XT and the $800 RX 7900 XT, which is probably why AMD coincidentally dropped the 7900 XT to about $710 on Wednesday via some well-timed sales. This does not appear to be a permanent price change for the 7900 XT, but it could entice some 4070 Super buyers away with the promise of better rasterization performance and a 20GB VRAM configuration. But perhaps the best news for this launch is that 48 plus hours after going up for sale, you can still buy them. The 4070 Super is still available, even if you want a base level $600 model. Couple at 610, and they go up a little bit from there. If you are about to buy a GPU though, especially a $710 RX 7900 XT, you might want to give it just a bit more time for the rest of the January 2024 launches to drop. The RTX 4070 Ti Super is up next, which should be up for sale on Wednesday the 24th, and while there's no way to be sure of this, last week the Wednesday launch was preceded by a Tuesday review embargo lift, and we are of course doomed to repeat history until we learn to properly interpret subtle hints like these. Point being though, at $800, the 4070 Ti Super, despite having a name so redundant NVIDIA was too embarrassed to slap it on a Founders Edition, will be the most price-relevant contender versus the Radeon RX 7900 XT and XTX. And thanks to brave early leakers who probably gave their lives to provide this data to us, we have what appears to be pre-launch Geekbench results for the 4070 Ti Super. 229,043 for OpenCL puts it actually a little bit closer to the 4080 versus the 4070 Ti non-Super. And in the Vulcan test, there were actually two scores. One was at about 192,000 and the other was its 222,435, which I'm noticing right now was transcoded improperly on this convenient chart. It was put up by WCCF Tech. That should actually be flip-flopped with the 4070 Ti Super result right there. But noticing the discrepancy between those two scores, which is a pretty wide margin, WCCF chalked it up to probably an OC for the higher one. I chalk it up to pre-launch info being dubious, as these are leaks sourced from BenchLeaks on Twitter. So let's see if we can all just be patient for another like 48 hours or so, and then we can discuss how best to spend that $800 envelope of cash Grandma gave us for Christmas labeled GPU money. Speaking of envelopes full of cash, you might want to start one up labeled CPU upgrade as well, if this rumor is true. AMD's next-gen Zen 5-based CPU family for desktop PCs is codenamed Granite Ridge, and indeed many CPU enthusiasts experienced rock-hard protuberances of their own earlier this week when Twitter leaker Kepler_L2 uttered a single word, yeah, which was in response to being asked if Granite Ridge is in mass production, which apparently it is, which means it's all the more likely that AMD will debut the new chips at Computex in early June. We're expecting them to slot into existing 600 series AM5 motherboards, although a new chipset design and motherboard series often comes alongside a new generation of CPUs, so that wouldn't be a surprise, and we will likely see improved performance and efficiency, as well as the integration of dedicated AI hardware. But further details are still a bit murky. It's also likely that they'll be called the Ryzen 8000 series of CPUs, which would be far more appropriate than AMD's current Ryzen 8000 CPU lineup, which are actually 7000 series CPUs. Not that I'm bitter about that naming scheme or anything. Speaking of the wholesale bastardization of product naming schemes in an attempt to misdirect hapless PC shoppers, the Ryzen 8000G series of APUs, announced at CES, will also be launching at the end of this month. And despite their lofty moniker, some early motherboard listings are already revealing the ways in which AMD has cut these chips down to slot in at various price and performance levels. Beware the Phoenix 2 configuration, budget buyers, which will be used by the two lower-end 8000Gs, the 6-core 8500G and the OEM-only 8300G, because, according to Gigabyte's spec sheet for the new B650E Aorus Elite X AX Ice, what a name there as well, Phoenix 2 only has 10 usable PCIe Gen 4 lanes, meaning many motherboards will have limited connectivity for discrete GPUs and M.2 NVMe add-on SSDs. This will vary based on the motherboard's configuration, but in some cases the GPU might be limited to PCIe 4.0x4, or M.2 slots might get two PCIe lanes instead of four. There was a scare in this article about DDR5 being only single channel as well, but that seems to have just been a typo. All this is to say, if you're considering the 8000G APUs for an upgrade path build, since they will likely have reasonably good integrated GPU performance to get by on, you'll probably want to opt for the Phoenix 1-based 8600G or 8700G, unless you're planning to upgrade both your CPU and your GPU when you finally switch to discrete graphics. And yes, this is another reason why these APUs have no business being called 8000 series. And now we move on to tech briefs, where I will continue to be snarky about PC hardware stuff. I'll just be doing it a bit faster. Another irritating marketing thing that companies do is try to attach a previously successful product's name to a new product that's not nearly as good. Like when AMD brought back FX processors in 2011, referring to that time in 2006 when the CPUs were beating Intel badly. And long story short, it didn't work. Believe it or not, the name has little bearing on the CPU's performance. So it was with some consternation that I saw Intel doing the same thing this week, launching a Black Edition Core i7-14790F, a CPU that actually has fewer cores than its non-Black Edition 14700F counterpart, and apparently the same base and boost clocks, just a tiny bit more cache, 3 MB, hooray. And this is added to a 14th gen Intel lineup that already has way, way, way too many options in it. And so I ask, just why Intel? Black Edition used to mean something, at least China only. Something else that's China only, at least for now, is the disassembly of perfectly good GPUs to be repurposed as AI accelerators. And Tom's Hardware has a report on several locations where this is taking place, including a factory that claims to have done this to 4,000 plus GeForce cards in just December 2023. For some, this is a curiosity, and for others it's a concern, as demand for GPUs to do things other than gaming has been a bit of an issue in recent years, specifically with the shortages caused by crypto mining. And while AI is a bit different, it's very true that the RTX 4090 is tougher to find at MSRP these days, and it is coincidentally also the most sought-after GPU for this kind of repurposing. If AI startups continue to feed on gaming GPUs in this way, especially in areas like China, which are subject to export restrictions for higher-end AI solutions, it could start to impact availability once again. Or on the other side of the coin, there might be more scam victims who are sold RTX 4090 housings with the GPU and the memory removed, which is apparently becoming more common, according to reports on forums in China like ChipHell. And I can't help but wonder where those GPU-less video cards are coming from anyway. Speaking of things I warned you about last year, SSD prices appear to be on their way back up after bottoming out back in November. You see, for commodity products like NAND flash, manufacturers sometimes make a bunch of it, causing prices to go way down, before they realize, hold on a minute, we want to make more money. So they coincidentally all start to cut back on production, without any secret meetings or collusion, of course, which causes prices to go back up. And then, 6 months or a year later, regulators get involved and tell the companies, hey, you're not supposed to do that, now you have to pay a fine that's probably way less than the profit you realized by doing all those shenanigans in the first place. And I sound like I'm joking, but seriously, this has happened many times before, not just with NAND, but with hard drives, memory. Anyway, you should have bought SSDs back when I made my video in late October, and in the meantime, SSDs will probably cost 15 to 25% more than they did back then. This will probably be the last time this happens, though. I was really hoping to hear more about BattleMage from Intel's graphics team at CES, but the second-gen Arc GPU is still only being hinted at. We'll probably see the architecture debut as an iGPU in Lunar Lake CPUs, expected in late 2024 or early 2025. Still, a rumor popped up this week, courtesy of Red Gaming Tech, who said that Intel probably isn't aiming to produce an RTX 4090 killer with BattleMage. In fact, RGT says the top GPU in the lineup will have a 192-bit memory bus and just 40 XE cores, 8 more than the current top-end Arc A770, and the A770 has a 256-bit memory bus as well. We certainly don't mind more competition in the mid-range GPU market, and I think Intel has done a good job breaking in their first-gen Alchemist cards, but it is a bit disappointing that there aren't more high-end GPUs from Intel, or AMD for that matter, providing some competition for Nvidia. Lastly, there was much outrage expressed earlier this week when YouTube apparently started another anti-adblock push, causing systems with AdBlock and AdBlock Plus installed to slow down, with increased buffering times and overall system resource usage spikes that slowed down people's whole PCs, not just the Stanley Cup review video they were trying to watch. But apparently YouTube is blameless, this time around at least, and the fault lies with the AdBlock extension engine, specifically version 1.1.1, which was released last week. New versions, thankfully, have fixed the issue, and we can go back to hating on Google and YouTube for the other times they tried to inconvenience us all so they could make more money. Or, you know, just use Firefox and uBlock Origin, and then you can laugh about all this from the sidelines like we currently do with that whole China repurposing GPUs for AI thing. What could go wrong? Sounds like a catchphrase for 2024. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.